Now let's think about how these responses will be represented in our dataset. For starters, we'll need a variable to capture the response for each of the cancer questions. Here I'm just naming them cancer 1 through cancer 5. If this were a real survey, you'd likely want more descriptive variable names. Say the first participant was told that they have cancer at some point, so they will have a value of 1 for the variable cancer 1. And because they had cancer, we ask them the rest of the child questions. Our second participant was never told that they have cancer, so they will have a value of 0 for the variable cancer 1. But what value should we give them for the child questions? As you probably guessed, for the second participant, the value for the child cancer questions will be missing. We never asked the questions, so missing is the only value that logically makes sense, right? Now let's look at another set of questions. Here, the parent question is, have you smoked at least 100 cigarettes in your entire life? This question is commonly used to classify a participant as someone who has ever smoked or not. It may not be entirely intuitive, but if someone has smoked 99 cigarettes in their life and honestly answers this question, we consider them to be a non-smoker. We may also want to follow up with questions about age at smoking initiation and number of packs smoked per day. And again, if the participant tells us that they haven't smoked 100 cigarettes in their life, then we skip over the child questions. And again, the skip pattern will result in missing data in our dataset. Now let's take a moment to step back and consider all of the data in our dataset. Our skip patterns resulted in missing data for cancer 2 through cancer 5 for participant 2, and missing data for smoke 2 and smoke 3 for participant 2. Your first instinct may be to say, they're all missing, so none of them convey any information to us. And looking at each variable in isolation, you'd be totally correct. However, when combined with other variables, sometimes there is actually information hidden in the missing data. I'll add a couple more observations to our dataset and show you what I mean. Let's first look at the smoking questions. Suppose we want to know the average number of packs per day smoked in our target population. Our first instinct may be to take the average value of smoke 3. That would give us an average of 1.25 packs per day. And if we qualified this answer by saying, among smokers in our target population, then this answer is the answer we're looking for. We're done. But that isn't what we said we wanted to know. Our original question was about the average number of packs per day smoked in our target population, period. That implies everyone in our target population, not just smokers. So how does that change things? Well, participants 2, 3, and 5 currently have a missing value for smoke 3. But when we consider smoke 3 in the context of their answers to smoke 1, don't we actually have more information than the data currently indicates? Sure we do. If these participants are non-smokers, then they smoked 0 packs of cigarettes per day during the last 30 days. Now, they could have lied to us or something like that, but that's a topic for another time. For now, we'll just assume that answers are truthful and that they do a good job of measuring the underlying phenomena we're interested in. So, someone who says no to smoke 1 truly is a non-smoker. And now our estimate is very different. In fact, it's fewer than half as many packs per day as our previous estimate. So, what have we learned? When there's a skip pattern, you need to think about your specific research question. Is it affected by the skip pattern? In the previous example, we saw how the skip pattern had to be accounted for when we were interested in knowing something about all the people in our target population, but not if we were only interested in the subset of our population that smoked. Second, the other information available about our participants matters. Here, I'm calling that the context. We would not have been able to adjust our estimate without the information contained in the variable smoke 1. But does having a skip pattern alone always satisfy the conditions above? Or more concretely, every time there is a skip pattern, does it follow that our question will require us to account for that skip pattern, or that there's enough informational context to account for the skip pattern? Well, let's look at our cancer questions. Does it make sense to ask something like what month, on average, everyone in our target population, including people who have never had cancer, were told that they had cancer? No, of course not. Does knowing that they have never been told that they have cancer provide any information that would allow us to fill in a month value? No way. However, knowing that they've never had cancer would tell us something about whether or not they've ever had breast cancer, wouldn't it? And it may be perfectly legitimate to ask what proportion of your entire target population has ever had breast cancer. So again, when there's a skip pattern, you must always consider your question and the context, and then determine if you need to account for that skip pattern in your analysis. So how do you know if there's a skip pattern in the first place? Well, if it's your survey, you should just know. And you should communicate that information in a code book or data dictionary. If you're doing a secondary analysis of data, you should familiarize yourself with the corresponding code book or data dictionary. A good code book will explicitly alert you to any skip patterns. For example, this is a section of the BRFSS code book. This particular question is asking participants when they last had a Pap test. Here you can see the possible answer choices. And here you can see the number, in percentage, of participants who gave the various answers. Finally, if you look towards the bottom of the screen, you will see that 420,189 participants don't have any value for this variable. And you will also see some notes about why they are missing. It says that if their sex was 1, which is a male, or if their value for HADPAP2 was 2, 7, 9, or missing, then they were never asked this question. This should immediately be setting off your skip pattern radar. Let's quickly take a look at HADPAP2. Although it may not be immediately obvious because you can't see the entire codebook here, if the participant says no, don't know, not sure, or refuses to answer this question, the instructions tell the person administering the survey to skip the rest of the questions in this module, which includes the question about last Pap, and go directly to module 14.05. So it may not always be formatted this way, but every good codebook should alert you to any skip patterns that were used in the survey. Another indicator can be lots of missing data. It's possible that the data is legitimately missing and there is no contextual information available. However, I often find that when a high proportion of data is missing, especially on the big national surveys, it's often because of a skip pattern. And remember, that's exactly what we saw in the BRFSS example. 420,189 participants out of a possible 441,456 participants, or 95%, had a missing value for this question.